Hi, my talk today will be dedicated to a mathematical method which helps to plan radiation therapy procedure for treating cancer. Specifically, we will consider intensity modulated radiation therapy machine, which is a kind of advanced technique used today in hospitals in order to irradiate accurately, as accurately as possible, cancerous tissues while reducing or keeping moderate or low damage to healthy tissues around. So here is the title of my talk: sparse solution for intensity modulated radiotherapy via conic programming. Conic programming is a kind of nonlinear optimization technique. Michael Цибулевский, Michael Цибулевский, it's me, and this is a joint work with a student, Avishai Adler. Here you can see a picture of IMRT machine. It rotates around the patient body and irradiates it by hard X-ray radiation. And the main part of the machine is a system of moving rulers, so-called collimators, which can cover, restrict part of incoming radiation. So they are placed it here, in this part. Because of position of this so-called multi-leaf collimators, of these leaves can be arbitrary. Actually, one can think about all this area as a system of pixels where every pixel can irradiate a prescribed dosage of radiation. And those pixels, they are called pencil beams or beam pixels or pixels. And our task will be to program, to plan which angle of device we want to use, which set of angles, and which positions of rulers or collimators in order to irradiate the cancerous tissue as accurate as possible and in order to limit irradiation of healthy tissues. Now, let us suppose that IMRT machine has a P possible direction of radiation field. This is first position and first direction. I will give it number one, second one, and number P. And suppose that the machine has n pairs of collimator leaves. It means that it's, as you remember, so-called pixel. So it has n pixel radiation beams. And each one can radiate the body with some intensity xi. Now, what we usually do we subdivide the volume of the body into small cubes. It's called voxels. And for example, J will be index of this voxel from 1 to m. And what we also will need, we'll need the constant dij, which will be computed by physicists, and they will tell us if I send a unit radiation to the pixel xi, how large will be dosage contributed to the voxel J. And this gives us background for mathematical setup of the problem. So the first and most basic problem that people solve in radiation planning is so-called linear feasibility problem. How it is defined? Suppose x is a vector of radiation in all beamlets, and d is a dosage matrix with elements dij, which say how unit of radiation in xi contribute to the dosage in voxel j. So dx is a radiation vector of radiation obtained in all voxels. And what we say that in cancerous tissues the dosage should be larger than some minimal required value. But we also want in healthy tissues, in non-cancerous tissues, the dosage will be should be lower than prescribed value, and those values are different in different voxels because tissues have very different sensitivity to radiation. So this is a linear feasibility problem. So it's like mathematical programming usually have objective function and constraints, and here we don't write at the moment objective function, we only we only define constraints. And if we found such a plan, our plan is x, how many radiation to put in every beamlet, which satisfies constraints in optimization, it's called feasible plan. Now, our problem is linear with respect to radiation in beamlets, but it is strongly non-linear with respect to angle of radiation field. If you would like to put angle of radiation field as a variable, you would have a very difficult optimization problem to optimize which angles are the best for the treatment. Here we suggest another way to deal with this problem. We say the following. We will consider a problem with all possible set of angles. Say we will later see two-dimensional simulation, there will be 180 angles, but actually the machine is special, so the number of possible angles will may be really large, and we will put something into objective function in our optimization problem that will enforce only a small part of angles to be used. How can we do it? We subdivide our vector x of all intensities in all beamlets into small vectors, and I give them upper index x1, x2, and so on, xj, where j is running over all possible directions p. And we suggest to add to our feasibility feasibility part to our constraints on dosage this kind of objective function. Sum of two norms without square of those vectors. This is a rather known objective function. It is in use for almost 10 years in various applications when we want to enforce sparsity not by variables but by groups of variables. We want that some groups will be present but many groups will be totally zero, and we did some work in this direction on something like 2002, and there were works of Malyutov and his collaborators, and also Remy Gribonval made a very significant impact in this area. And this is rather common tool to enforce sparsity by groups. You can think about vector of norms of these groups like a long vector of blocks and some can call it combined L1 L2 norm, because on this vector of two norms you like enforce L1 criterion, which is usually people use in enforcing sparsity in basis pursuit and so on. I'm not sure how clear my explanation. I guess they may require to refer you to papers where joint sparsity is used for sparse signal representations and so on. Okay, and by the way, I should note that despite that people use here two norm, actually it may be even preferable to use some p norm or q norm with index larger than two, up to infinity. We didn't do any numerical testing on this yet, but it's one of our future directions. And I will show you later by simulation that this approach actually works rather good. And one more thing, sorry, I forgot to note. Also in previous part, of course, vector of dosage is non-negative, and this is another constraint, another very important constraint. The problem we got is, on first look, not very pleasant optimization problem, because its objective function has non-smoothness regions where xj is zero. There is a recently developed and now very established area of mathematical programming, which is called conic programming, and as a particular case is optimization over some of some objective function with constraints that our feasible area should be inside of a second order cone. And I will just show you rather standard way to convert this kind of problems to the conic optimization. We just introduce artificial variables xi I, one for every term in our sum. And we introduce constraints that xi I is greater or equal than norm, xi j, than norm x j. So if you will look at the long vector xi j and x j, this is vector and this is scalar, all this vector, this constraint says that this vector belongs to a cone. If you say, if you would have two variables, xj1 and xj2, sorry, xj1, xj2, xj2, and here is my variable xij. So I have a vector of three variables, and my feasible area will be inside of this second order cone, which is defined by graph of the norm of the vector xj. So this is a rather standard way of expressing such kind of constraints. And also we have our previous constraints, which are linear constraints on dosage and non-negativity on x. And this is a standard formulation. So there are tools in MATLAB, in C, and so on, which can treat those problems. And we used one of those tools, which is called MOSEC. I hope that I don't do mistake. Actually, I don't remember. Is this Q or C in the end? And this tool allows to treat rather large scale problems, relatively large scale problems with maybe several thousands or tens of thousands of variables. We still need more powerful method, and this will be our future work, really to work with hundreds, thousands, or maybe millions of variables, which are actually in real three-dimensional setting of this problem. Now, after we solved the problem assigning intensities to every beamlet, we should return to our basic problem of setting the collimators. Let me one second to find my best picture. Yes, I want just remind you how the machine is built. So we have here such rulers, collimator leaves, they called, and we can set them in different positions, and then give exposure for some time, and then change position, and so on. And effectively, we want to reach our goal to get every to get a radiation, prescribed radiation from every pixel of this plane, from every pixel or beamlet. Okay, so how can we do it? I would start with most straightforward and naive way. I look only on one collimator pair, and my task is to radiate from this strip, from every square on this strip, some prescribed radiation dosage. What can I do? I can make some opening between these leaves and exposure for some time, give some radiation from this opening. Then move all of this pair down, keeping the opening the same, and give some exposure for other time, which is proportional to XI, which is my solution, and so on. So in this way, I will give the set of position of the same pair. Pay attention that this is the same pair of rulers, and so on. But I have also other possibilities. If there is some constant part in my profile, yes, that there is a profile how intensity changes with radiation, I can expose it in shorter time, just letting a very large opening to my rulers, and in general. I have this system of possibilities, so I can move with some narrow opening, and then increase the opening, say, twice for example, and then explore all possible position of this larger opening, and then increase it even twice more. How can I do it? For example, in this way, and then explore all position of this opening, and so on. In this way, we get to very interesting and very standard mathematical problem. You can think about these openings as rectangular basis functions of different widths and which have all possible translations, and they form not basis but some over complete system of functions, and we would like to express our profile of intensity as a linear combination of those functions. And the weight exactly will be the exposure time of every basis function. And if we like to minimize the total exposure time, we just will put objective function of minimizing sum of weights. So the problem we get is the following. We denote the coefficient, the exposure time, as Cj. This is vector of those exposure time for direction j. We have p such directions. So we minimize just sum of those times. Subject to our profile xj, our radiation profile, which we got from our previous conic programming optimization, is expressed via those coefficients with this with the basis matrix psi, where the rectangular functions I mentioned are the columns of matrix psi. And of course we have non-negativity constraint, and we should do the set of such optimization for every direction, for every angle. And now I only want to show you some simulation results. So we considered such a problem simple two-dimensional setting. For example, suppose that there is some cancerous area in the middle of this form, and we put a lower bound on radiation in this area, so we want the radiation in this area to be above some number in every pixel. And there are other areas in the body, part of them are less sensitive to radiation, those gray, whiter areas, brighter areas, and darker areas are more sensitive to radiation. So in dark areas we put low upper bound on radiation. We do not allow high radiation in this area. And in other, probably a bit higher. And here are results of our first part. Here we see the optimization without joint sparsity constraint. We just put it objective of minimizing sum of squares of radiations everywhere. It has no specific physical meaning, but for some reason it rather widely used. And it just looks for best feasible solution in some way. Okay, so what do we see here? This is the actual amount of radiation, and you see it's pretty good. It's rather strong in the area where we wanted to irradiate, and rather low in other areas. And here you see difference with prescribed lower bound. So you see this central area is really radiated in right way in large dosage. The difference between prescribed and actually is small. And also in other areas the difference is small because there was a zero prescribed radiation, and it is really low there. And also upper bounds are satisfied rather good. The only thing about this solution is that it used all 180 directions which we built into our simulation. Now here is a joint sparsity solution. It is less uniform, as you see. Still prescribed area is irradiated rather good, but you see this paths. It shows that some radiation, despite that it was in feasible bounds, came also to other parts of body. But but actually what we managed to do, we got very few directions. I don't remember how much, something like 11, I guess, which were used. And in this way we approached real limitation of machine, because machines are built in this way that we cannot use all 180 directions. And some more details you will find in computer slides. You just may see that the upper and lower bound constraints were satisfied in this case as well. Now I show you the second set of simulations. It related to the second problem, find the optimal positions of collimator leaves, of rulers. And here are some preliminary results. Again, it's for two-dimensional setting of the problem. It means that our collimator leaves have only one pair of ruler for every direction of radiation. And you see the solution obtained with this L1 norm of basis pursuit kind of formulation. It's of course better than if one would just use L2 norm regularization as objective. And even better sparsity we get if we do some reweighting, giving smaller weights for larger windows, which are more efficient. And now a few words about possible future work. What we would like is to unite, to use some general objective function which unites naturally several goals of our optimization. The first goal is minimize collateral damage of radiation to non-cancerous tissues. So, sorry, I missed here some important part. So it's U transpose D psi C. Let me explain. Wow. It's, I realize now it's too general writing. I just will explain you by words. So we see our exposition for all rulers for different positions. Psi is a matrix. It actually should be block matrix, which translates all these expositions of different rulers per position into intensity of beamlets. Now we have D, the matrix which translates intensity of beamlets to the radiation dosage obtained in every voxel in the body. And now we can say that we also know that different tissues, so different voxels, have different sensitivity with respect to potential damage from radiation. And this different sensitivity is expressed in the vector U. So all this expression shows collateral damage from radiation in unwanted areas. This is the first term. So the second term is like we already used, which enforces sparsity with respect to direction. It chooses from the continuous or almost continuous set of possible directions several directions of use. And again, like I told, we actually in our computation used the second norm without square. And it may be even better to use some Q norm with Q larger than 2 or even up to infinity. So from every direction we might like to minimize maximal value of beamlet in this direction. So we really want it to be zero in as many directions as possible. And here is the third term, which I introduced the maximum and one more index. Okay, in our simulations were two-dimensional, and we and J was direction of radiation, but also we have we introduce here index I, which is a number of ruler pair, and for this pair of rulers of collimator leaves, there will be different position and different exposures, and all them will be exposed in vector C I J. I J is a vector of such expositions. And what we actually want, we want to minimize overall time of exposition of the system with given direction J. So it's not important for us every pairs of rulers in independently. It's important maximal over I exposition, which pair will be critical, because before it passes all its positions, we cannot move to the next angle. That's why. Okay. So again, angles are J, and then I do maximal over I. Maximal over all rulers, the total exposition time. And this is my third term. And of course, one should tune these two constants, mu and lambda, to find optimal trade-offs. Or even after, say, we use some relatively large mu, for example, or even lambda, to find the optimal setting, settings we then can choose those concrete angles and do optimization again without this penalty term. About lambda, one should think a bit more carefully. And of course, this was an objective function, and the constraints are like we already wrote, constraint on dosage, delta low less than equal d psi c less equal delta upper, and also of course c greater or equal to zero. Okay, that's all at this point, and questions, and thank you for attention.